At this point, the female witness ran away, but we have obtained a dramatic account of what allegedly happened next from another witness who was in a car only a few yards back. Also wishing to protect his identity, he has given a detailed statement to a lawyer representing this week.
The man on the ground was lying on his back. The man standing over this man had his foot on the man's chest. I could see that he also had a gun in his hand. I then saw the gunman point his gun deliberately at the man that was lying on the floor and fire two or three times into him at point-blank range. I was horrified by what I saw.
Our information is that the bullets that killed Savage were fired into his neck. Only the pathologist's report at the inquest can establish what range they were fired from. A vital question is why the terrorists were not arrested. Was minimum force used? The yellow card rules in Northern Ireland say a soldier may only fire at a person who is likely to endanger life, and there is no other way to prevent the danger. For a fuller legal definition, we ask George Carman, a leading QC.
The general rule of law is fairly simple to state. Such force as is reasonable or reasonably necessary to prevent crime in order to defend yourself or to defend others is justified in law. But quite obviously, having stated the general principle, everything turns on the particular facts of a case. At the one extreme, there is no unfettered license to kill. At the other extreme, extreme danger requires extreme measures to be taken.
The Renault car in the centre of town was the basis of fears that there was extreme danger to the public. It was suspected that the car contained a bomb. In the week following the shooting, several newspapers carried stories based on Whitehall briefings suggesting that the terrorists could have suddenly set off a car bomb by radio using a miniature device concealed in pocket or handbag. Not mentioned was the fact that the car was almost a mile and a half from the point where the terrorists died, with buildings and a city wall in between. We asked George Stiles if a remote control explosion had been a possibility.
Well, I would say very unlikely indeed. There's so much building work and the undulations of the ground and so on. I doubt if they could ever set that car, the white car, off from the other side of the tunnel. On the rock there's all sorts of radio waves going about. If they could send a signal, I think it would be swamped anyway by the other communications.
Last week we asked the Ministry of Defence in London if the IRA has ever set off a radio-controlled bomb at a range of more than a mile out of line of sight. The ministry declined to comment, giving the forthcoming inquest as their reason. Another strange fact is that according to the Gibraltar police who were involved, the area of the Renault car was only cleared at 4 p.m. after the three terrorists had been killed and at least 2 hours after the car was parked. It will no doubt be argued at the inquest that these facts leave out the uncertainties, confusion and fears that often dog military operations. And under the law, the soldiers involved will only have to demonstrate that they held a reasonable belief that the terrorists represented an extreme danger. And it could be argued that a threat to life was posed by the nature of the terrorists themselves. All three had violent records and McCann was known to be a deadly killer. There was a possibility that he or the others was carrying a concealed weapon, and their reactions, if challenged, could not be predicted. Sir Geoffrey Howe told the House of Commons that when challenged, the terrorists made movements which led the soldiers to conclude that their lives and the lives of others were under threat. But in her most controversial statement, witness Carmen Proetta, who saw the deaths of Farrell and McCann by the petrol station, says that the incident began with the sound of a police siren and that there were no threatening movements from the terrorists.
No. There was no sharp movement. It was the movement of a person that is walking towards somewhere, doesn't know what's going on when they hear a siren, and it's a normal gesture of somebody that just moves when they hear somebody or some noise or some sort of unfamiliar or whatever noise.
And then as they turned, they must have seen coming towards them over this railing,
yes,
men with guns. What movements did they make then, these two terrorists?
They didn't make any movements. They put their hands up. I believe I've said it before. Yes, they just put their hands up.
Was this a reflexive gesture, or were they actually trying to give themselves up, do you think?
It was like giving themselves up, like unresisting gesture.
An unresisting gesture. As if they were trying to surrender, is what you're saying?
Yes, like saying, look, what's happening, we haven't done anything, or some sort of like that.
Well, this is the killing ground. This is
George Stiles, who is also a ballistics expert, believes that what Carmen saw could be explained by the impact of bullets travelling faster than the speed of sound, striking the terrorists and throwing their hands in the air. But reviewing the shooting as a whole, he believes that a clear-cut decision was taken to eliminate the terrorists as cleanly and safely as possible.
I look at the whole piece as being two active service units waging war, and thank goodness our side won. The battlefield was one of their choosing in the first place, that is the general community. And I think it would be reckless for the security forces to have tangled with these people who may well have been armed, as we've seen on other occasions. So taking them out quickly, cleanly, and without other people getting hurt, that seems to be the only way.
What is important on the one hand is that Her Majesty's government take all proper effective steps to stamp out the scourge of terrorism. And I imagine that's beyond dispute. Equally, on the other hand, it is important that the measures that are taken, however extreme and necessary they are, fall within the rule of law, which governs us all. Because even the activities of soldiers or police officers who have to face the awful problem of terrorism has to be conducted within the framework of the rule of law. So, of course, it is desirable that there should be a full examination of what actually occurred.
Our inquiries into the shootings in Gibraltar have revealed a number of important and troubling issues. No independent witness has told us that they saw or heard the security forces challenge the terrorists. Carmen Proetta has sworn in an affidavit that she saw two of the bombers shot with their hands in the air. Another witness says she saw the third terrorist shot in the back as he ran away. Two witnesses say that they saw the terrorists being finished off while they lay on the ground. And deeply disturbing, George Stiles, an acknowledged expert on bomb disposal, says that the security forces should have known within minutes of examining the white Renault 5 that there was no significant bomb in the car. Clearly, all these questions require deep and complex investigation to establish the truth. But doubt remains as to whether that will happen. One reason for disquiet is the role in the shootings of the Gibraltar police. They apparently drove the SAS men to the scene and certainly took them away again minutes later. One question is whether the police force that helped to carry out the operation is the right body to investigate it. Another question concerns the nature of the coroner's court where this highly controversial inquest will eventually take place in this small outpost of empire. The court can produce a wide range of verdicts, including, in theory, homicide. But Mr. Felix Pizzarello, the coroner, would be the first to admit that both his experience and powers to investigate are limited. The Prime Minister has declared that his inquest is where the facts should be established, but a leading QC has doubts.
The coroner's court is a perfectly proper place to investigate ordinary fatalities. But where great public interest and matters of public importance are involved, such as this case that you've been talking about, it seems to me desirable that some senior judicial power, such as a High Court judge, would be much more appropriately appointed to investigate a matter and preside over an inquiry of this kind.
Do you believe this case is so important that the government should actually consider such extraordinary steps in order to clarify the facts?
It's not for me to advise Her Majesty's government as to what steps they should take. But clearly, from everything you say, the programme indicates that there are serious, important public issues involved. And speaking as a lawyer, one is always anxious that where there is contest on the facts in such important areas, they should be properly and efficiently investigated.